without a microphone is because we're still holding for just a second. Maybe it looks like everybody's gotten their tickets now. I think we might be ready to go. Can you give me some on green, Pat?
You are in for such a treat tonight. My face hurts from smiling so much all day long, hanging out with these guys. This concert is so special. We've had on this stage Jack Shantz, John Reese, the John Reese Project, Eric Marienthal, Andy Martin, Roger Ingram, Bernie Dressel. Tonight, somehow, tops all of that. Somehow, I know how. These guys are amazing. And I feel so lucky to be able to present things like this, and I want to thank the people who are making it possible. Bill and Karen Verity. Let's have a round of applause for them. Bob and Linda Sebo. Give them a round of applause. Our good friends at Premier Tour and Travel. And a company you probably never heard of, a German instrument company, Chagrel Instruments, sends the Chagrel Jazz Trumpet All-Stars on tour, including to Boardman High School tonight. So give Chagrel Instruments a round of applause. And I need to thank a few people for allowing this to happen tonight. This is not a week on the jazz calendar. We weren't supposed to be in here tonight. But Patrick Kale, BPAC manager, and our drama director, Jonathan Linko, allowed this to happen tonight. So thank you guys. We really appreciate it. We're going to get started with Jazz 2 just after a safety announcement.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Boardman Performing Arts Center. Please take a moment to locate the exit nearest you in the event of emergency. We ask that you turn off or silence all cell phones or other electronic devices. Thank you and enjoy the performance.
Thank you so much. How about it? Willie Murillo. James Morrison. All these wonderful students, and one who's not a student anymore, John Reese on trombone, my good friend coming in for us tonight. That was a tune called Whoopin' Blues. Here's Cold Duck Time. Yeah, remember the holiday concert a few weeks ago? I didn't talk at all. Not happening tonight. Thank you.
Yeah. Oh, we gotta take a picture.
We're going to change pace a little bit and feature some very dear friends of mine. On bass, former student of mine, one of our best bass teachers nowadays, and a gigging musician all over the place. And he's teaching also, not just privately, Vinny Vavacqua on the bass. Jazz Ensemble 2 is going to go head off. Come on, Vinny. A dear friend who I've played with for many years. On piano, Mr. Jack Charnello. And I need to rearrange some things on the drums. They set them up weird, so give me a minute to do that and we'll be right back. Maybe Willie will talk to you in the meantime.
How's everybody?
Isn't it fun to be out on a school night like this, all late and everything?
Yeah. Did everybody get their drinks okay?
Delivered right to their seats?
What do you mean out late? It's like it's not even 8 o'clock.
This is late for me. I have 5 children.
Okay.
I go to sleep very early.
This is late. It's wonderful to be here. We've had a fantastic day working with the students, talking to them, rehearsing with them, and answering their questions, and just having an inspiring time. And it's fantastic to cap it off, to get together and play for you all.
I want to mention something while we have a moment to do so. Two big things about your director here. Don't we love Tom?
He can dance.
Yes. I just want to mention something. The fact that James and I are here is a huge indication of his love for the program, not because we're so great, but because you guys have had Eric Marienthal and Andy Martin and the Big Fat Band. And this is a director that says, hey, these things are important, to bring in outside influences, to let students know that what they want to do, we're doing. There's people in the world doing it. And this is kind of a funny industry. You can't kind of put it in a box, and you got to know people who are doing what you're doing, and it's not like being a nurse. There's lots of nurses, but professional musicians, it's a little more rare, and so the fact that he makes it accessible is really
it's not impressive. Nearly as hard as being a nurse, let me tell you that.
This is true.
My wife is a nurse, and she says to me, what, you're going out to play the trumpet again? I see. When are you going to get a job?
So thank you guys for coming out. Also, you're going to hear him play drums right now. Have we heard him, Tom, play the drums? He's fantastic.
We're just going to do a small set with a small group now, a few tunes for you. This one, there was one written by, and it's called, I Want to Be Happy.
We'll give the illusion that we're reading music. I can't read music. I tried it once. Way difficult. Thank you.
You're going to cool off for a sec. Yeah, let that. Can I put that in cold water? No, you're not going to go and cool off. You're going to put the trumpet down. Play some percussion. Yeah, we're going to do a song. What kind of rhythm would you call this, Willie? A bossa rumba. Is that like a rumba? Yeah, but like it's a little bit funky too. It's like a kind of a funky kind of Afro-Cuban, sort of swinging jazz rock, classical rock, punk, waltz, reggae, calypso kind of feel. You know, if you can imagine that. If you can, I'd like to meet you. We're going to do a beautiful song written by Luis Bonfá. You know, I've always loved Brazilian music, and I went to Brazil many years ago for the first time, and a friend of mine showed me around. We went and heard some samba band, heard all this stuff, and to finish off the night, he said, let's go down to this little, very tiny place down the stairs, you know, under the ground. We went down and held about 50 people, and they were all crammed in. Just two guys there with nylon string guitars, no microphones, no amplification, and just doing jogum songs, and turning color, you know, so Golfo Ipanema, Desafinado, Corcova, all those, and just singing them and playing nylon string guitar. And it was beautiful. You could hear a pin drop. It was so authentic. And I thought, how beautiful on my first night in Brazil to find some people that are doing like a tribute to Jobim, you know, just doing Jobim tunes. As we walked up the stairs afterwards, like 2 a.m, I said to my friend, that was so great, you know, to hear a Jobim tribute. He said, what do you mean? I said, to hear a Jobim tribute. He said, that was Jobim. Yeah, I didn't know what he looked like. I said, I've got to go back and meet him. Yeah, so he wasn't doing a night of Jobim tribute. He was doing a night of originals. Anyway, it's beautiful music. We're going to do a song now. Having done that fantastic intro, we're going to do a song not written by Antonio Carlos Jobim. This song was written by another of the great Brazilian composers, Luis Bonfá, and it's called The Gentle Rain. Thank you. One more song with a small group before we go to the next jazz ensemble. This one is a very old traditional gospel tune that I don't think we've ever played this before, but we just thought of it. I mean, I didn't mean we just thought of it, it's an old song, but we thought of playing.
Just got back from a vacation in Puerto Vallarta, Mexico, and he happened to bring his horn because he knew he was going to be playing. He wanted to keep his chops up. The jazz trio in the hotel lobby saw it, invited him to sit in. He ended up playing 5 nights out of 7 of his vacation.
Thank you. Thank you. Jack Charnello, Vinny Bamacqua, John Reese, Ryan Murillo, James Morrison.
Thank you so much. We're going to get Jazz One on the stage. I suppose we can do this without even Vinny says same time next year. Let's get him back next week.
My hope is that you all, as parents and friends of people in this program, are totally aware that your kids, your students are safe and in great hands with Tom. What a phenomenal person. We were just having a great conversation backstage before the concert about the importance of directors being able to play their instruments, and I have a big bench for that. And I think it's so wonderful that he can play at such a high professional level. And I gotta tell you, I've been around him before with students, and I love when I can tell that the students respect and respond well to him. And as a lover of education, I really am, it's a big deal for me to walk into a school and go, ah, okay, good, they're covered here. They have something great. Because it really is, plus post-COVID, you know, really difficult stuff. A lot of programs are down, less interest, and there's lots of reasons why and lots of things, you know, we could post-conjecture about, but the future of music is safe here with you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Really great job, Tom. Thank you.
It is truly an honor to be with these students every day, let alone with such amazing artists as our guests. When I first met Willie, Jazz Ensemble One was asked to open up for Gordon Goodwin's Big Fat Band, a very famous LA big band. And that was at Stanwell Auditorium, 2014. We went down for a sound check, and afterwards, the Big Fat Band was gonna do their sound check, and my students were sitting in the audience. They took seats in the audience, and Willie came to me and said, where are your kids? I said, they're right down there. He said, no, they need to come up. At least get your trumpet players to come and stand by us, the guys in the Big Fat Band. Who was there? Dan, you?
Wayne.
I don't think Wayne was on that one.
Yes.
And so the guys were so nice, and at that moment I realized, oh, these guys aren't just great musicians. They're very interested and very much advocates of music and jazz and education. So they were just all about it. And I didn't really know how much James Morrison was an advocate of education until today, when he came in, and that's why my face hurts. It's probably killing you too. Because of smiling so much, hearing him talk to my the whole band class, fourth period today, they came in and did a master class, and the things that he was saying, sure, the musicians would have gotten great value out of it, but it was common sense, positive, enlightenment, encouragement for anybody in any field of interest. It was just really beautiful. It's a psychological approach to education. And I know that he's such a great teacher. He has his own academy in Australia. And Willie teaches at the Los Angeles College of Music, is Conservatory of Music? What is it?
College
of Music. And they're just, I can't say enough, and I certainly can't find the right words to say how appreciative I am of them and their commitment to education, and especially music and jazz education. Give it up for them for being such great teachers. And I want to commend my students, because I mentioned the holiday jazz concert. That was December, 15th? Is that when we played? That was just a month ago that we had a concert. And I said, guys, they can come in on January 17th. We have to learn almost a whole new set of music. But they were so excited to have Willie and James on our stage that They buckled down and got it. So we're going to feature Jazz Ensemble 1 and our guest artists. Here's one that you may have heard at the concert in December, and then everything else is new.
Thank you.
by the way, I wanted to mention something really quickly. How many of you are jazz students? Ever played in a jazz band, anybody? All right, I love it. Not that many people. And I love to remind parents of these concerts because, you know, we all have kids and we send them off to school, and I have a bunch of kids. I have a gaggle of children. And I send them off to school and I say all these encouraging things. Do great today and be nice and be inclusive and love people and all this stuff. And really go out there and do the thing. We forget that what these students are doing up here is really like adult, difficult level kind of stuff, you know, with all these scales and these instruments. And I had a parent ask me, they're like, is it really that? I mean, it's just wiggling the finger. And I said, listen, I would invite you to come up here, and I'm going to hand you the microphone, and you're going to speak for 5 minutes on the Vietnam War. Here you go. That's kind of what it's like. You know, you're accessing all this stuff and these abilities and these scales and these sounds, but more so, they're giving of themselves. They're putting themselves out there. And so it's a really cool thing to watch because they go about it with reckless abandon. And we said, who wants to play on such and such song? 10 hands go up. Me. And so it's really great, and I want to congratulate you students for doing that. It's so awesome. You're really great.
Thank you.
So I was born in a very small town in the west of New South Wales in the outback in Australia. Telling the kids today the population of the entire town would have fitted easily on the bandstand. And it's true. And there were no brass instruments there, not at all, nothing in that town. There was the organ in church that my mother played. My dad's a preacher. And there was a piano at home. That's all I'd ever heard. That and a record. I forgot to tell you, my mum had a record of Scottish Highland music with bagpipes. I don't know if that counts. Anyway, we moved to the big city and I saw a brass band for the first time and I was knocked out. I started playing in the brass band on the cornet. I was walking home one day, age 7, with my cornet, and there was a guy on the side of the road with a banjo, like sitting in the back of a van, like a combi van with the sliding door open, you know those, and he's sitting on the step playing the banjo. And you could see that sort of thing. It was a pretty rough area. And that's a joke. Banjo's not that bad. And I heard this rhythm. I'd never heard anything like it. Because all I'd ever heard was the music in church and the brass band at school. And there's this guy playing jazz on the banjo, playing this rhythm and these chords, and I was captivated. I went over to him and I said, "What's that?" And he said, "It's a combi van." And I said, "No, the music." And he said, "It's jazz." And he showed me the melody to the tune he was playing, taught it to me. I went home, it's the first jazz piece I've ever played, and the first jazz piece I ever heard. And we'd like to do a rendition of it for you now. I think some of you will know this. It's called the Basin Street Blues.
See you at the end.
I should mention that once again, for the fourth time in my career here at Boardman, this band was selected through a blind audition process to perform for the state music convention. And not many bands can say they can do that. So this year it's only two high school jazz bands, and this is one of them. That little nugget of information is why I say this is the best jazz ensemble, high school jazz ensemble in Ohio. They sound pretty jazz. This is one of the songs that we'll be playing. I wish we could take James and Willie with us for that, and John too. But I don't know if they'll allow it. Plus, you guys are kind of busy.
Thank you.
I thought it was about time to sort of, you know, lift things a little bit more decorum and do something dignified and have a trombone battle rather than another trumpet one, you know. It gets so messy.
Yeah. Well, we're glad you did it.
Everyone knows trombonists are more dignified than trumpeters.
You guys keep telling yourselves that.
Oh, this one. Right.
Thank you.
couple more for you. Oh, I do have one thing to say. The kids who are participating Friday in the OMEA District 5 Honors Jazz Band, please stand up. Most of the band was in it last year, and then everybody else at the other schools caught on, so they sent in their auditions, but we still have eight, the most in the Mahoney band. So, come down to Peoria on Saturday. Get online and get tickets to that. Three great bands, Mahoney County, Ashtabula, and Trumbull County. Thank you.
James Morrison, ladies and gentlemen, Willie Murillo. Keep it going for Vinny Bobacqua, Jack Charnello, our good friend John Reese. How about it for Jazz Ensemble 2? And the amazing Jazz Ensemble 1.
So we've just about come to the end. Just about come to the end. We have one more song to do now. This is jazz, right? I know you knew that, but we're going to do something that is jazz. It's not, jazz isn't just a style of music or a way of playing. It's a way of being. And one of the things about jazz is we haven't rehearsed all this stuff because Willie said, you know, look, I don't want to over-rehearse. I want to leave something so it's a little bit dangerous, you know. I don't think it's dangerous enough.
Okay.
Yeah, so we're going to take it up a notch. So you know that stuff we said we'd do with this song, how it's going to start? That's not going to happen. So I got an idea. I'd like to attempt for you some multiphonics. Yeah, for the uninitiated, which from your response I assume is all of you. Multiphonics is just a fancy word, just means more than one note at one time. Two or more notes together is multiphonics. When you hear the band, it's multiphonics. But on one instrument you can play multiphonics. I mean, you do it on the piano all the time, right? Yeah, no one cares. Because it's easy, right? I mean, same, they don't care about me doing it either. Guitar, you can do six notes at once, right? Do six notes at once for me. That's six notes at once. Not the six I would have chosen, but anyway. And you can do four notes at once on the bass, right? Yeah, look at this. She's got even got the hand position. I don't want to try and do that. But that's because it's got four strings or six strings or hundreds of strings on the piano. I'm going to do it on trombone. And as incredible as this may seem, or not, well, not only no strings, only one tube. One tube, two notes. How can that be? I'm asking a drummer, really? So I'm going to start the piece like this, I'm going to start the piece on my own on the trombone. I'll play two choruses, 24 bars, and then you're in, okay? All right, but the 24 bars starts after I start the time, not the first little bit. I'll look at you and give you that look that says, we're right.
That's one.
so much, ladies and gentlemen. Our sponsors, Bill and Karen Berry, Bob and Nicebo, Premier Tour and Travel, and Chaparral Instruments.